The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. As a father shows compassion to his children, as the Lord shows compassion for the faithful. For the Lord knows our frame and remembers that we are dust. The steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon the faithful, and the righteousness of the Lord to the children's children. Friends, we have gathered here today to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Laura Mae Henderson. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace, that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. I invite us to stand as we sing together.
Able said the Master to be crucified. join me in the unison prayer. Almighty God, our Father from whom we come, and to whom our spirits return, you are our dwelling
place in all generations.
You are our refuge and our strength,
for
the present of time. Grant us your blessing in this hour, and enable us so to put our trust in you, that our spirits may grow calm and our hearts be comforted. Lift our eyes beyond the shadows of earth and help us to see the light of eternity.
So may you
may find grace and strength for this and every time of need. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading from Psalm 8. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands and have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The scripture reading, 1 Corinthians 13. If I speak in tongues of human beings and of angels, but I don't have love, I'm a clanging gong or a clashing cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and I know all the mysteries and everything else, and if I have such complete faith that I can move mountains, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. If I give away everything that I have and hand over my body to feel good about what I've done, but I don't have love, I receive no benefit whatsoever. Love is patient. Love is kind. It isn't jealous. It doesn't brag. It isn't arrogant. It isn't rude. It doesn't seek its own advantage. It isn't irritable. It doesn't keep a record of complaints. It isn't happy with injustice, but it is happy with the truth. Love puts up with all things, trusts in all things, hope for all things, endures all things. Love never fails. As for prophecies, they will be brought to an end. As for tongues, they will stop. As for knowledge, it will be brought to an end. We know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, what is partial will be brought to an end. When I was a child, I used to speak like a child, reason like a child, think like a child. But now that I have become a man, I've put an end to childish things. Now we see a reflection in a mirror. Then we will see face to face. Now I know partially, but then I will know completely, in the same way that I have been completely known. Now faith, hope and love remain, these three things, and the greatest of these is love.
Scripture reading from John chapter 14, verses 1 through 7. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places.
If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you'll know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. And now from Hebrews chapter 11. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain's. Through this, he received approval as righteous, God himself giving approval to his gifts. He died, but through his faith, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken so that he did not experience death, and he was not found because God had taken him. For it was attested before he was taken away that he had pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, for whoever would approach him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. By faith, Noah, warned by God about events as yet unseen, respected the warning and built an ark to save his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir to the righteousness that is in accordance with faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance, and he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God.
Thank you.
There's a reading that is printed in your bulletin, and Laura has picked every scripture and every song and every reading that we're experiencing together today. And as we've been singing, I don't know about you, but I can hear Laura's voice channeling every single word of everything. What an amazing life, and we will be talking about that in a little bit. But if you would read those words to live by silently, she left them for you. And we will watch also a slideshow of her life that was put together by Greg. So.
Thank you.
So Laura left me this file folder with ideas for the service, and then evidently she came up with a later one that Greg sent to me. And if Laura had her way in both of those, we would be singing 20 hymns and probably about 10 different scripture verses. So we honed them down a little bit to try to give an essence of who Laura was, what she would have wanted us to celebrate together. But evidently hymns were a huge part of her faith journey. And she, I've been here 6 years, so she would sit right in the back there and just smile. And she was such a vital part of this congregation. And so I took a little liberty. And she chose Hebrews 11 for her scripture to be preached on. So I wrote Hebrews 11, the 2021 version. By faith, Laura walked hand in hand with her Lord and Savior as she navigated the waters of the civil rights movement, as she lived life as a pastor's wife, mother, and grandmother, and as she served as a tireless advocate for biblical literacy and justice for all. And it is counted to her as righteousness. Because I'm thinking that if the writer of Hebrews had been writing today, I'm pretty convinced that how he would have ended this section on faith. So those themes that Laura put out have been modified over the years to what we have seen today, but there are some remarkable insights into her life in the notes that she left for the pastor who would celebrate her life. She called them her life's highlights. Her parents, Caroline Ponzu Winston and William Wise, attending public school in Washington, Pennsylvania, and college at Washington Female Seminary and Michigan State University. Her marriage to William Thomas Henderson on March 28, 1948. Her two sons, William Thomas Jr. and Joseph Robert. And then she wrote, and I love this, additional parent too, William Butch Bell, Claudia Jean Boyce Berry, Christina Aurelia Boyce Williams, Glenda Darlene Peterson, adopted grandsons Jamal and Willie, her chosen daughter and son Trisha Adams Cooper, Gregory Sasserita, and Daniel Fund. After college, she worked about 25 years as an academic advised retention specialist at MSU and the University of Arizona. And then she added these words: my God-given mission while on this earth and my main contribution was helping others to have the best possible life. And she quoted Joyce Wyman, 100 years from now, it will not matter what kind of house I lived in, what my bank account totaled, or what kind of car I drove. The world may be different because I was important in the life of a child. And then she divided the service that she designed into two parts, mostly hymns and scriptures under the headings, My Tribute to God and My Life in Faith. And that pretty much says it all. Laura gave all the glory to God, and she lived life fully immersed in her faith in the saving love of God in Christ Jesus. Known at Desert Skies for her beautiful hats, her infectious laugh, her strong and vocal advocacy for racial justice, her delight in new experiences, and her love for Jesus, her presence among us is sorely missed. But her faith in a marvelous God will never be forgotten by those of us who knew her. During the terrible days of the Blitz, a father holding his small son by the hand ran from a building that had been struck by a bomb. In the front yard was a shell hole, And seeking shelter as quickly as possible, the father jumped into the hole and held up his arms for his son to follow. Terrified, yet hearing his father's voice telling him to jump, the boy replied, "But I can't see you." And the father, looking up at the sky, tinted red by the burning buildings, called to the silhouette of his son, "But I can see you. Jump." And the boy jumped because he trusted his father. The Christian faith that Laura shared so beautifully with all of us enables us to face life or to meet death, not because we can see, but with the certainty that we can be seen. Not that we know all the answers, but that we are known. And that attitude was embodied by Laura in everything she said and did. That kind of faith is so rare these days. At least, it's not something that we hear about very much. Unless, of course, it's a negative connotation, like when our faith is placed in something that fails. For instance, a little while ago, Apple had to issue a warning. Evidently, customers who were using a GPS National Parks Hiking Trails app on their iPhones were warned about some serious glitches. In several national parks that identified trailheads, the mileages and the directional guides were completely off. And so some hikers got seriously lost because they trusted downloaded trail information that was fatally flawed. Those hikers had faith in the electronic guidance that their hiking app had given them. But that faith was rewarded with a wandering in the wilderness kind of experience. If truth be told, we don't take much on faith anymore, at least from human sources. I mean, anything a politician or a government bureaucrat or a corporate CEO or even now an athlete says and swears is now immediately suspicious and suspect. Network media, government warnings, and recommendations of professionals like doctors, lawyers, financial advisors, these days we take all of those with a hefty dose of skepticism. Except, as the emergency Apple app warning revealed, we do seem to place faith in our electronics. It seems like today we have more faith in artificial intelligence than human intelligence. I mean, we put almost all of our private information, personal, financial, medical, emotional, and we trust that it is safely stored away online. We routinely hit send, secure in our faith that our message will go swiftly to its appointed destination without interception or invasion. We trust our family trips to a GPS screen and a computer-generated voice that tells us where to go. I mean, what would you all do today if you got in your car after the service and you were suddenly instructed to drive your car around the city of Tucson 7 times, honking your horn along the way? What if your GPS insisted that that was the only way to reach your desired destination? Would you have faith and follow those directions? Probably not. But in the Hebrew text that Laura wanted us to read today, it is that degree of faith that the author holds up for us and names it even later as a great cloud of witnesses. And so we remember the story of Jericho, where Joshua got some pretty bizarre-sounding instructions from God. He and the people were to stomp around the city 7 times while blowing horns and culminate the march by gathering their voices together in one big shout-out. And that was the divine answer to toppling the walls of Jericho. You know, Joshua and the Israelites had lived a hardscrabble life, 40 years wandering in the wilderness, generations of slavery in Egypt. They knew that it took a fight to defeat might. And yet, they responded and obeyed those weird words out of faith in God who had delivered them from slavery and promised them a future. Faith in God. Faith in a future. Faith in the church, faith in her friends, faith in her ability to raise her children and grandchildren. Faith. Laura had faith. And living a life by faith opens doors to amazing possibilities, as Laura discovered personally. You see, a by faith life gives you an attitude of yes instead of no. A by faith life opens one up to receptiveness instead of defensiveness. A by faith life addresses challenges and real hardships with a spirit set, not a mindset, of why not, and moves forward instead of bewailing why me and collapsing in defeat. You know, the examples of faithfulness given in the Hebrews text are all over the map. Those specifically named experienced true triumphs and affirmations because of their faith. But we also read in the biblical stories that they also fell flat at times in their life with extraordinary failures. Because a life of faith is not a perfectly lived life. But it is a life that knows how to reset itself when it goes off track. Faithfulness, you see, is not a state of being. It's a state of becoming. And faithfulness is an ongoing process of reset and reboot. And Laura was a master at that. Resetting and rebooting throughout her life to meet whatever situation presented itself. She trusted that God would see her through everything. When Hudson Taylor went to China, he made the voyage on a sailing vessel. And as it neared the channel between the southern Malay Peninsula and the island of Sumatra, the missionary heard an urgent knock on his stateroom door. He opened it, and there stood the captain of the ship. "Mr. Taylor," he said, "we have no wind. We are drifting toward an island where the people are heathen, and I fear they are cannibals." "What can I do?" asked Taylor. "Well, I understand that you believe in God. I want you to pray for wind." "All right, Captain, I'll pray. But you must set the sail." "Why, that's ridiculous. There's not even the slightest breeze. Besides, the sailors will think I'm crazy." But finally, because of Taylor's insistence, he agreed, and 45 minutes later, he returned and found the missionary still on his knees. "You can stop praying now," said the captain. "We got more wind than we know what to do with." You know, we sing songs and hymns like, "I believe, trust and obey. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus." But how many of us actually trust in God and believe in the power of prayer and hope and faith? How many sing and mean, "Take my life and let it be"? Or how many of us sing and really mean, "Take my life and let me be"? Trusting in the faithfulness of God, letting go with hope for the future, getting down on her knees and trusting that God would provide the wind when the sails need wind, Laura did that so well. Theologian Reuben Alves put the difference between faith and hope like this: hope is hearing the melody of the future. Faith is dancing to that melody here and now. Laura showed us throughout her life how to dance to the melody of the future, of life lived with God. Will all of you honor her memory and dance to the future with her this morning? Will you follow her example to live by faith and be ready to jump even when you can't see your destination? Will you trust God with all you are? Will you lean on the everlasting arms? Laura showed us all how to do that, and we are eternally grateful. Amen. I would invite Greg to come and share a witness on behalf of the family and friends. If any of you would like to share, we can't pass the mic because of COVID, but you are welcome to come up and use either of those mics if you would like to do that this morning.
Anybody hear me? Okay. Thank you, Reverend Candace, for that wonderful homily. And thanks, everybody, for contributing to this wonderful service, the choir, organist, audiovisual, Ken, the usher, Teresa, and the others in the background. And I want to thank Darlene, your family, for coming, Willie, and friends who've come here, too. As Reverend Candace said, you know, Laura choreographed this whole thing, scripted it. But this is a celebration of life. One thing she couldn't script was what family and friends have to say about her. And so I'm going to start right here. I have many fond memories of Laura that could fill a book. But don't worry, I whittled it down to a single page. I met Laura 26 years ago. We lived in the same neighborhood right down Houghton Road, the street that passes in front of this church. Laura and Bill recently adopted their grandsons, Willie and Jamal, who couldn't make it here. But those boys are the reasons we met. I have two sons the same age as Willie and Jamal. The kids became instant friends, so I often paid Laura and Bill a visit to fetch the boys, my boys, Spencer and Adam. Many of you know that Laura loved flowers. She grew roses, crepe myrtle, and other different flowers in her backyard. When she moved to Fellowship Square, Laura was sad that she had to leave all her flowers behind. I told Laura that she should go to see the beautiful flowers in Hawaii. I'm from Hawaii, so I would be her personal guide. Most people would jump at that offer, but not Laura. She had all kinds of excuses of why she couldn't go. Bill can't go, too far, cost too much, and this went on. She told me that she would ask God to fly her over Hawaii after she died. Well, after more than a year, I finally convinced her to go. In Hawaii, there are flowers everywhere. When Laura got there, she was in heaven. After not wanting to go to Hawaii, she didn't want to leave. She kept asking all my relatives if she could stay with them. One of the places I took Laura was in the movie Waterworld. Some of you may remember that. It was near the end of the movie where Kevin Costner found dry land. The place is called Waipio Valley, and the road down there is extremely steep. You need a four-wheel drive to get down there. Laura wasn't comfortable driving down and wanted to walk. I told her there was no walking. If she stepped out of the vehicle, she would tumble down to the bottom. So she just closed her eyes and prayed. Laura was in awe when we got to the bottom. She raised her walking stick with both hands and started chanting. On one of the slides, showed her down there. I thought she was chanting, but she was actually reciting the story of creation, how God created the world. I never saw or heard her do that before. I feel truly blessed that God allowed our paths to cross. My life has been so much more enriched having been able to spend time with Laura. My name is Gregory Sasserita, and I feel honored that Laura called me her chosen son. And now I'm going to ad-lib one of the favorite poem that Laura liked. She would recite a portion of it. And it said, poems are made by fools like me, but only God can make a tree. So anybody want to say a few things, Darlene?
I usually can't get up to do this, but I felt like this was a very important day to honor Aunt Laura slash mother. She actually raised me from the age of 11 until where I am today. And I'm not gonna divulge my age, but she raised me my whole life. She was probably the best mother that anyone could ever have. So I'm just gonna read a poem, because she did love flowers and roses, and she would always make us go get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and go pick the weeds out Saturday mornings, Joe and I, every Saturday. So I don't have a green thumb like her, because I probably don't like flowers because of that reason, but it's okay. The poem I'm going to read, it says, "If Roses Grow in Heaven," by Dolores M. Garcia. It says, "If roses grow in heaven, Lord, please pick a bunch for me. Place them in my mother's arms and tell her they're from me. Tell her I love her and miss her. And when she turns to smile, place a kiss upon her cheek and hold her for a while. Because remembering her is easy. I do it every day. But there's an ache within my heart that will never go away."
Praise the Lord. I'm Elder Walter Bradley, Aunt Laura's son-in-law, Darlene's husband. Aunt Laura came and visit with us a couple of years ago, about 3 years ago. And she didn't even want to go back home. She wanted to stay. I said, "Well, Aunt Laura, if you want to just stay, just go get your stuff together at home and you can stay with us as long as you want to." And I just thank and praise God for Aunt Laura, because one day she heard me preaching. She's like, "You one of them sanctified preachers." And she went to jumping up and clapping it. And she was just the life of the church that day. And she gonna be greatly missed, but she knew she had a daughter. She was gonna be fine. She with me. We ain't going nowhere. And Aunt Laura had so much love for everybody. She wanted to love on everybody. And she used to tell me these little sweet stories that her Uncle Bill, she was like, "You know, you want to keep a lady sweet, you just keep her some candy." And my wife, we used to have these candy mints in a bowl. And Aunt Laura, every night, she would basically come and get all the candy out the bowl. And my wife used to be saying, "You know, you got to, she eating too much sweets." And she was like, "She got to keep her old lady, she got to keep her sweet." And so I was like, "Just let her eat the candy, it's okay. Just let her, just get some more and just let her eat." Because truly I believe as we do what God would have us to do, when we get old, we got to remember we reap what we sow. And if you don't sow right now in your youth, who you gonna have to take care of you when you get old? And so I thank and praise God for Aunt Laura, because she sowed and she did so much for everybody else in her time of weakness, and she couldn't do nothing for herself. God blessed her with peoples to come around her and take care of her. So I do want to just thank and praise God for each and every last one of you. God bless you.
How you guys doing? So I didn't write anything, but I'm Darlene's son as well. So Aunt Laura, it's my great aunt, but she's like a grandmother to me. And I would call her frequently. And every time I saw her or called her, she had a couple things to say to me. One was, "When you getting married, when you having kids?" And I always kind of pushed it to the side. But she always greeted with me with joy and laughter and jokes and sarcasm, tons of sarcasm. And I always enjoyed the times that I spent with her. She always, you know, gave me words of wisdom, you know, unwarranted, you know, unsolicited, but I do remember it, and I will miss her. She's greatly missed. Thanks, guys.
I'm Fred Killian. I'm a member of this congregation. And I always looked at Laura as someone who was kind of up here, and I was kind of down here. And one day she approached me after church and asked me if I'd come and spend some time with her and talk to her. And I was honored and a little bit intimidated. But I went to visit, and she really wanted to talk about her grandsons. And she knew that I'd spent a lot of my career working with young people and families, and she had so much love and so much concern and care, and was quite worried about her grandsons, and wanted me to talk to her and give her some ideas and maybe even talk to the boys. And we did that a few times, and from that we developed a friendship. I just enjoyed going over and spending time, and she would share with me her childhood and her life, and heck, we even talked about basketball and kidded about going over and playing a little one-on-one. That didn't happen because I was afraid I might lose. But, you know, we reached a point where we put some plans together and some ideas, but she just never felt like she was giving enough to her grandsons. And it was a really major thing for her. And at the time, I was teaching Vacation Bible School for the junior high school kids, and we decided on a project, and the project was to select someone from the congregation or a couple people that could show the kids a little bit of the history of the church and show them what real love and devotion of God was all about. But the way we approached it with the kids was to tell them that they were doing something special for this person. So the project was to meet her, talk to her, put together a collage of her life, and then later we would go back and present that to her. And the whole purpose for me was to see her get joy from being able to give, and these kids get joy and understanding from getting a chance to meet her. So we took about 8 or 9 middle school kids over to her apartment. And we sat on the floor and we talked for hours about her life and her Christianity and her belief in God. And it was so fulfilling. These kids were just locked in to every one of her words, as was I. And I've always been one that questions my faith. And she would reassure me over and over, even if I didn't know all the scripture and even if I didn't follow the Bible as closely as some, that my devotion to God and serving children and people was something that she devoted her life and that was okay. So I just want to thank her for giving so much to me and giving me the opportunity to be part of her life. And I finally got over being intimidated, but I still looked at her as being up here. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Champagne, the mother of Laura's great-grandchildren. But I just wanted to, I've always been told to say things out. If you speak it out loud, then it'll come back to you. So I guess today I got to say thank you, Miss Laura, for letting us into your lives, for being a great-grandmother to my kids. Just thank you for everything that you did for us, and we love you. There was a famous saying, I don't know famous, but there was a special saying that she used to have with my daughter and my son a bushel, and a peck. Say it again. A bushel and a peck and a hug around the neck. So that's what we will remember from our grandmother forever. So thank you.
Laura and Bill had a reaffirmation of their vows, and I was privileged to be asked to sing at that occasion. As much as Laura loved flowers, and I think this is very telling, she did something I've never seen done before. When she came down the aisle, she wasn't holding a bouquet of flowers. She held a little Bible, and that just... I've always remembered that. She also gave me a little gold and crystal magnet of an angel that I think of her every time I see it, which it's on my refrigerator, so I see it all the time. She'll be missed.
I encourage us all to keep sharing Laura's stories. There'll be an opportunity at a reception following the service to eat together and to share stories. And so I hope that you will all participate. All of you are invited as well. We will be putting her ashes in our memorial garden with Bill's. And so you are all welcome to come over to the Memorial Garden immediately following the service, before the reception. It's pretty hot out there, though, so you make the choice. You can either go in the air-conditioned fellowship hall and wait for the family, or you are welcome to join us. So we do extend that invitation as well. So let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To those who have sinned, mercy. And to all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we trust you. Oh God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Laura to us, so now we give Laura back to you. Receive Laura into the arms of your mercy. Raise her up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Amen. She asked us all to sing Let There Be Peace on Earth together before we left our service together. So I invite us to sing that together. Dana will lead us. So let's channel Laura as we sing this song together.
With God.
of Thanksgiving. God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us even to this day, for the gift of joy in days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends, and for our baptism and place in your church, with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death, and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us as he taught us. So now we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
May the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, according to the riches of God's glory, grant you to be strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your inner being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of God which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen.
Amen.